So I'm here with Graham Bartlett, a former policeman and author of a new book called Babes in the Wood. Graham, tell us all about the book.
So Babes in the Wood tells the inside policing story of how Sussex Police responded to and eventually managed to convict Russell Bishop for killing Nicola Fellows and Karen Hadaway back in 1986.
Yeah, and this is quite an important case for Brighton. It's a very famous case. Just tell us a bit about that case, because it took quite a long time to convict Russell Bishop.
Yeah, so what happened in October 1986, Karen and Nicola were taken from near their home, taken into a wood in Wild Park, sexually assaulted, strangled and murdered. Russell Bishop was eventually arrested and stood trial, and he was acquitted of that offence. And then 2 years later, he kidnapped another girl from Whitehawk and did essentially the same to her, but up at Devil's Dyke. And for that offence, he was eventually convicted and was sentenced to life imprisonment. So it took eventually 32 years once the law had changed to allow people who'd previously been convicted, previously been acquitted of offences, to be retried and reconvicted, and the science to be able to prove that, for Bishop to finally face the justice that he should have served back in the 80s.
Yeah, and he was convicted on some really strong forensic evidence in the end, which using techniques that weren't available at the time of the crime.
Yeah, that's right. It all centred around a sweatshirt, essentially, a blue Pinto sweatshirt. And at the time, it was very clear that whoever had murdered the girls had been wearing that sweatshirt. And the sweatshirt was found dumped not too far from where the girls were killed. But what the police couldn't prove at the time, because the science didn't allow it, was that that was Bishop's sweatshirt, that Bishop had worn that sweatshirt. So in 2015, the DNA science had moved on so much that it was proved that Bishop had worn that sweatshirt and worn it around the time, but also that he'd touched Karen Hadaway's arm, which he could only have done during the course of killing her, because during the whole day, Karen had been wearing a long sleeve sweatshirt, and the only time she wasn't wearing one was when she was found dead. So he must have touched her arm while he was killing her.
Because I know you've been involved in policing, so you kind of show the human side of policing in and around our city. So tell us a bit more about the content of the book.
So the book explores the inside story of policing. So most people, certainly in Brighton and Hove, know the case. They know the story. They know what happened. But what they don't know is, you know, what it was like to first respond to that call. You know, the two girls had gone missing. What they don't know, which they'll find out, is what it felt like to be the first officer to go to the girls when they were found dead, and the impact that's had on that particular officer for 30 odd years. Nothing in comparison to what the families have been going through, but certainly, you know, that human side. And then, of course, we go alongside all of the investigating officers and how some of the decisions were arrived at to, for example, arrest and charge Bishop. What happened on the night that the girl was kidnapped from Whitehawk, and I was actually on duty on that night and was involved in that investigation personally, so I can tell that from my perspective. And then how the frustrations were felt that we couldn't bring justice to the family until the law had changed and science had caught up. And then the brilliance of the officers towards the end, who eventually got the conviction.
So it was a new law, wasn't it? A double jeopardy law had to be reversed. So I think it's for a separate Stephen Lawrence case, I think, led to a change in the law. So you could be tried for the same offence twice.
Yeah, that's right. It was the Stephen Lawrence inquiry that made the recommendation that the law changed. But it's an incredibly high bar. First of all, it has to be a very serious offence. It has to be murder or rape or robbery, kidnapping, those sorts of offences. And then the prosecution and the police have to show that they've got new and compelling evidence to justify that previous acquittal to be quashed, to allow the person to stand trial again. And it can't be evidence that was around at the time but no one thought to look for, or, you know, it has to be genuinely new. So in this case, it was the DNA. And the DNA has to be so striking that it goes to show that Bishop was the killer.
Yeah, and what can we learn from the policing techniques back then to the modern day? What are the lessons that can be learned from that, this case that you explore in the book, from the Babes in the Wood case?
Yeah, I mean, essentially, most of the forensic work that was done at the time was of a very high quality. Nowadays, the DNA techniques are so sensitive that officers and scenes of crime officers have to be incredibly careful that they're not contaminating or putting their own DNA on the samples. But at the time, the forensic samples that actually proved the case were secured properly. I mean, they weren't secured for DNA. They were secured because they wanted to show whether there were fibres or hairs or other debris that might indicate that Bishop had been in contact with that shirt or either of the girls, and they later used that for DNA. I think what this case shows the public is that, you know, if you've committed a serious crime for which you haven't been convicted, you can't sleep soundly in your bed, because the science and the police will catch up with you. And the science is improving all the time, so who knows where this might lead.
Yeah, do you think in the future there's quite a few unsolved murders, aren't there, and unsolved very serious crimes? Do you think that we're going to be going using new techniques to go back more? I know there's a lot of cold case reviews now, isn't there? Not just at Sussex Police, but across the UK.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. There are cold cases being reviewed all the time, and the new science being applied all the time. And we hear about them in the news, and, you know, we probably can't mention a lot of them at the moment because they're still going through the courts. But, you know, these are all down to forces never shutting their eyes to their undetected murders and ensuring that they're using the best and the most up-to-date scientific techniques to prove them.
Yeah. Just lastly, we were interested in how the police process more and more. There's the programme 24 Hours in Police Custody on Channel 4, so people are interested in the process of how the police investigate crime. It's a good thing, isn't it, to open up the processes to the public so the public know as far as they can what's going on and how the police go about their daily work.
Yeah, and I'm a big fan of those programmes because I think years ago they tend to be a bit sensationalist. These ones, particularly the one you mentioned, 24 Hours in Police Custody, just show the thought, the intelligence and the hard work that goes behind it. And I think it's good for the public to see that.
Yeah. OK, we'll leave it there for now, Graham. All the best with the book launch, and we'll be catching up again soon.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you.